All right, I would like to go ahead and call this meeting to order. It's our 48th meeting, February 23rd, 2017. How about that? 48th meeting, that's interesting. Welcome all today. We have a fairly lengthy meeting, so we'll go ahead and get moving here quickly so we can get you back to your work. First order of business is the adoption of the agenda. If we can get that, please.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Next order of business is the approval of the minutes. You have before you your January 26th, 2017 meeting minutes. If there's any changes or errors that you notice, please bring them forward. If not, I'll entertain a motion to adopt the minutes, please.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. First order of business here, number five, updated proposed center for the Jacksonville Landing. At our last meeting, we had a presentation, and since then, there's been more discussion, and I think Deanna is with us today to give us an update on where we are today.
Yes, sir. And thank you very much. On behalf of Dr. Woodruff, he asked that I come back and give you an update on where we're at on the building. Just to kind of refresh everyone's memory, so we're talking about the Welcome Center at the Jacksonville Landing, and it's kind of sandwiched between South Marine Boulevard and Old Bridge Street. And this parcel is it's interesting because of how it's situated, that you're kind of accessible on all four sides, and so that was one of the concerns that we heard last month from your group, and we've taken that into consideration this time. The building initially was 45 by 50, but we went back with our consultants and we were able to actually grow the length about 10 feet, which actually helped us satisfy some of the other additional requirements that you asked for to look at maybe some office space. So last month we talked about the closed floor plan, and this included the women's and men's restroom with access both interior and exterior, with a storage area and then an open concept floor plan where you'd have a small reception area and two display areas. So from that, we said, we heard your concerns. We needed to get a little bit bigger. What are the site restrictions? And so here's the proposed building as it is currently. It is now 45 by 60, and we were able to kind of site in where the main entrance points would be. And so the first entrance point, can I draw on it?
Mm-hmm.
The first entrance point with parking is going to be here. The second one is going to be down in the side. And so as you're driving on Marine Boulevard, what there is going to be another entrance on this side. And as you'll see in a moment, that'll be one of your exterior main entrances right to the restrooms. But as you can see, we've actually taken the consideration that you can not only use the restrooms, but actually go into the main foyer area as well. Now, with us resituating the restrooms and adding office space, we actually realized that the driveway, as you come in off of Marine Boulevard, that this opportunity of this wall space here actually allowed us to create the hospitality room and two office spaces. And so at the top here is where that driveway is. So as you enter into any of the two main entrances from the parking lot, you enter into the assembly area, which is nice and open. You've got your display areas. We've got two offices that are 12 by 12. We have an open reception area that someone can sit and receive guests. We have a hospitality room. And then we also have the both women's and men's restroom. On the side here, and we'll get in a moment over on this side, is we'll actually have a covered area that you can walk in. It'll be the airlock doors, so as one enters, one exits, and it's you're safe from the environment. And so looking at the Marine Boulevard side, here's the revised concept where you've got the two double doors, some finishings. We've got the arbor covered walk area. This is facing the convenience store, so this is another main focal points. We've got some signage now that we've added.
Jesus. Okay.
This is the area that you would see now as you come off of the main the driveway off of Marine. And these are all the walls, the windows that you're going to see for your office space. And this is what now fronts Old Bridge Street, your other main entrance. So one of the benefits of the revised concept, as I go back, we realized that the old design that we had did not allow for any wall space. So anything, any display, any pictures that you wanted to hold, none of that was taken into consideration. And so with us redoing the floor plan, you actually gained quite a lot of wall space. And so we've got windows that we can account for as well. So we're hoping that we heard all of the correct comments from the board last month and that we've sufficiently addressed those, your concerns. We welcome any additional feedback or thoughts on the revised plan.
Okay. Thank you, Deanna. Any comments?
I think, in other words, we assume that our recommendations are outside. In other words, the bathrooms are they actually locked after the building is secured in?
It's set up either way. So okay. We could do it either way, whatever, as we get further into design.
I think we felt pretty strongly about keeping them closed for a lot of reasons after the building's closed.
Well, I like the fact that it has the flexibility. Yeah, let's just say there's an event. Let's just say that there's a flounder tournament, whatever, and they need the extra capacity for bathrooms. You have the ability to open them for a period of time while not maybe opening the whole building, but also being closed after it's formed. So I like the flexibility that it shows or that it has versus what we had before.
I'd like to have Ken look at it, man. I think it's a good proposal.
And I like the extra room for potential offices, and I like it much better. Ernie, any comments?
No, I wasn't at the last meeting, but so I'm catching up.
Okay.
But as I understand, this is near the convenience store, as opposed to where the boat landing is.
Right.
Correct.
So it's going to be a new structure.
It's a new structure. Yeah. When they was built, we had that pad ready for this project. And that's what Deanna's talking about when she's talking about what space we have available for that. That's the pad that we left for this building.
Yeah, it looks good. Now, the assembly area, is that 31 by 47?
It is 45 by 50 or 60 is what the new layout is.
The assembly area.
Oh.
That's what you got it right. It's 41 by 47.
31 by 47.
Mike, if I may, I was here for the last one. I notice now you no longer have the storage area. Are you planning to use some of the office space for storage? Because if you have maps, brochures, booklets, you're going to have somewhere to keep that information.
And Deanna can answer that, but what I'm assuming is that they labeled them as office, but you could use one office and one for storage, or if you needed two offices. And
because that will be...
We agree with you. The concept, too, that area that's marked reception, that might be something that later gets some more cabinetry or something like that that lets you do something with, and that the person who is there can be doing other functions at the time. And if I may, one of the concepts that I heard you say, and I heard from some others, in particular, kiosk is one person one time, one person at the time. Whereas you have wall displays, multiple people can be looking at those at the same time. And so why would we not want to ensure that we have something to take care of them as it is? I must tell you, in the session I sat through, there was a lot of discussion about where the front should be and what should happen. And I think all of us agree that the side toward Marine Boulevard is something that you want to be a nice presentation, no doubt about that. But I wonder if it's going to get as much use once people, if you go back to the drawing there, you know, because you'll have to go to the left to get to it, even though it'll have the sign there that says restrooms on the out of there. And I don't think anybody's got a strong, hard feeling, but we might want to look at flipping it so that the restrooms are actually on the side that's, you know, toward Old Bridge Street or something there, just so there. That would be, you know, more likely a way that people would go. I mean, you'd have that airlock, and it's probably not going to get as heavily used as certainly the western and southern doors to that place. But I defer to others.
The other thing that, which is a whole separate piece, you know, once the building is done, you know, maybe we can participate. I would like for it to be well utilized on the inside, and maybe we can put some money towards the electronics portion of it, whether it's screens and kiosks, and you know, we want to make sure that the displays and the feeling of when people go in there is good, and they have all the information that they need to explore our community. And I don't know what that means, but maybe we need to work with somebody, and that's how we can also add some additional funds to make sure that that's executed as part of the design plan.
Well, Lorette certainly has more experience than I do about visitor centers and things such as that from her previous life and that she had with us, but her words were listened to, you know, about this new redesign and such there. So
is everybody happy with the direction?
Yeah, as I understand, once again, I'm learning, as you come in off of 17, the side is going to be, I look at right elevation here, there is no door on that side as you come in off of 17.
On the driveway side.
No. Driveway side, there's no door.
There's no door.
But there are three doors on the others.
Yes, other three sides.
Yes, other three sides are, you can enter.
Where your parking spaces are.
Okay,
I can park and go in through the front, through the sides.
The only place that there's no parking is the side towards South Main Boulevard, but it's not like it's a far walk either.
Right. And one other thing, if it rains, for example, let's say if someone gets caught out, you know, in the rain parking lot, is there any type of cover?
Yeah, there is like a pergola stone, but it's not completely covered.
It's porous.
Yes.
Okay, I see.
Shade.
I was just thinking.
Well, that's the kind of input I think they're seeking now, is that, you know, what type of...
It would be nice if it was possible to have larger overhangs with some ambiance around the...
Or covering or something.
Well, which would achieve that, kind of like a big front porch, if possible. I think that that would add some character. And if you're using it to register teams or something like that, it would also help. You know, where they can put the kids out there, and it just...
Absolutely.
And it comes in handy when you need it.
Right, and those folks who may not be as ambulatory...
That's right.
You know, a little slow, and, you know, they may need to be under some cover or something. That's all.
One thing I kept hearing...
If it's a large enough area, people could register for whatever the event might be if the building on the inside as well.
We thought that that registration was going to be something for events, that this would be a primary location for that. And I think we can all think of some events that would have probably been much better suited had they had something to pick up packets and do things like that at a site like this than some of the accommodations we've had to make in the matter there.
Well, you've got the parking, you've got, you know, now you'll have the facility, and then as they're
easy
there,
access.
They can see the other things.
It will be visible. I think that's one of the things that you really get the point about this. People will be able to find this one. And that's not a detriment to things that have happened, but, you know, it certainly is going to be easy to find.
That's what you need.
Anything else? Okay. Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
We appreciate it very much. All right, we're moving on to item number six, strategic work of the authority. First order is the report for Jazz in the City. Glenn, will you be making that?
Well, yes, visually, and we might get Mr. Authority Member, but let's play you a little video here and let you folks kind of see what our folks saw when they went there.
Smiles all over her, or I can draw
I certainly want to thank Kimberly Tillman of our staff and Lisa Miller. Lisa went out there Saturday evening, and Kimberly was out there Friday evening, and we posted to visit Jacksonville NC and get some things like that in our social media and on our web and such there. And so that was a nice little piece there as it was.
Right. And the other thing, the specific statistics we'll have for you later. This is a short
just
report.
A preview.
I can tell you that it was, let me cut this off. There were about 250 to 275 people at Courtyard Marriott that evening. And everybody had a great time, said they would be back next year if we're sponsoring it. And we consider it, my fraternity thanks the tourism board, and it was a success. And a lot of people were there, and we gave away prizes. Baskets were from Wine and Wares and everything. We had a couple of gift baskets that were raffled off and everything to make it enticing and everything for everybody. So it was great. It was a great evening.
And they did do a survey Saturday night too, so we'll find out Friday and Saturday night, so we'll get more information on hotel stays and who stayed where. And
okay. We had them sign when they get their tickets to sign up for the basket, the raffle, they would fill out a survey.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how we were able to determine 250 to 275, because we had that many people filling out those things.
Great. Thank you.
Good idea.
Sounds like a good event. All right, next one, we have the Extreme 12K Endurance Challenge.
Now, if you remember, this is one of six races that you folks, as part of the Grand Prix series, and pursuant to your previous instruction, we're providing you with printed materials on those. You'll notice this one had 603 registered. This is not certainly the big race that they have, as it was. But even so, it generated at this time, this is the flash report. This is not the final report, 84 rooms as a result of that. And you can see on page 23, it tells you all the different places that people came from. And some of these are clearly evidence that they were engaged by the street crew that went to that location and recruited people as part of the expos that were held at those locations as it was there. So a real value. And of course, the way that MCCS calculates their value, they give an estimated economic impact of over $43,000. A final report is due 30 days later after the race, so we'll have something that's more engaged at that time.
All right, thank you, Glenn. Item number C, status report, Teresa.
We've been busy. We have a lot going on. As we brought up the last couple of meetings, Susan Dozier was here, and we have the familiarization tour, the FAM tour, scheduled for the weekend of March 10th. And we have secured three solid, and we have two pending journalists who are going to come in and spend the weekend with us and get their fill of Jacksonville. And hopefully from there, they will help begin to tell our story to some people that haven't heard it. That weekend is really busy. We're going to do one of the journalists is actually going to run in the St. Patty's run on base, part of the Grand Prix. So that's pretty cool. So we'll have film and some things to show from that.
When is that?
That is March 11th.
March
10th and 11th. Yep. Mm-hmm. And so we will guide these journalists. We'll take them on a guided tour, and we have everything set up in advance. So we will give them a full experience of Jacksonville and Onslow County. Then we also have that weekend the Engaged Onslow Bridal Expo, which has come along nicely. They have 70%. I think, is it 70% of the vendors are new? Mm-hmm. So we've gotten a lot of traction with this. And so that one's planned for that weekend as well. And the Hot Import Nights from the Sports Commission, from their efforts and the strategic money for that. So we'll be quite busy that weekend. Then we have April 7th, the next event is Mind, Body, and Soul. They've done a great job at taking some feedback and adding some elements to that weekend. One of the really cool things, I mean, they have some notable speakers this year, but they've also added a men's element to it, a men's piece, and it's for young men under 18. And we'll be promoting it specifically to them and their parents to encourage them to come. Mike Unero, Chief Unero, will participate in that. So it's real talk and bridging the gap And so I think that one's going to be really productive. So we'll have that going on as well. The art block is April 29th. As you know, they moved their date. The plein air piece of that, if you're not familiar with it, is the artists come in and paint, and they're given a list of options of where they want to go, and they paint historic or scenic architecture, whatever they, you know, see. And last year, all of the pieces were sold, but this is where we will get our overnight stays. So we've already had some traction on that as well. So that is a really big interest. There's a lot of people that like that. So they're also bringing in, the judges will be renowned in the art world. So that's pretty impressive to the artists who want to get their work seen. And then we have right behind that, Jacksonville Jamboree. So we'll be busy promoting that, and things are moving along.
Lots going on.
Yep. Quite busy.
And we do want to please have mercy on us the week of March 10th, basically 8th, 9th, 10th to the 12th as it was. These people will all be horribly busy. I'll be somewhat busy. She will be very busy. And Susan Dozer will be here. It's just so many things are going on at the same time.
And then we got the 14th and the 15th.
Yes. That's when Visit NC is coming to do their social media takeover. And that's part of that project, and we'll be hosting and helping them. And thank you all, our partners over here, they're gonna take care of them at some other location so we don't have to do all of it. So that's a really good thing there.
You wanna lead into item 7?
Yes, the projects basically, these are the initiative here. There's a paragraph that should have been taken out. Please forgive me on that. But on the reunion development, just today I spoke with the tourism staff, with Lorette's staff, and had some, they've got a couple things that are being booked as it is. One of them, unfortunately, is booked out of the area, so they're not going to be able to use some of the infrastructure that we've got developed for them. But it is showing how now we're starting to attract that they know where to go to get some information. So that's an important part of this, as it was there. In the additional sports development, sports events development, Marissa will speak to that. And then the docent program, we did meet with the United Way, and their project is advancing. This is going to be a very good project. And we're hoping during March that we use the services of the Sergeant Major and some others to help us with a practice tour of Lejeune Memorial Gardens. But I must admit to you, all the stuff that's going on in March, that might get pushed just a little bit as it is. I did not anticipate March to be quite that busy at that time as it is. And so that also speaks to the tour development project that's out there. And we have some great hope that we might be able to give you more good news about that at a future date, sir. That completes that part of the report. Do you want me to go right into the next stuff?
Item number 8.
Yes, sir.
Let's do it.
If you'll recall, during your November 2016 meeting, you voted to authorize us to go out and get proposals for a company that would do...
Glenn, before you go on, is there any questions regarding any of the union, anything? Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Forgive me for not asking.
Neglected to ask.
Basically, we were given permission to go out and seek options for a company that was would document and quantify, basically for our point of view, validate, excuse me, we're all about to cough here to death, aren't we? Validate who stays in our lodging facilities. I personally happen to think there's people around this table that could probably do this on the back of a napkin and we'd have it done and this would be it. But a more empirical review of that is necessary to facilitate some of our relations with state people and with our legislative goals. And so consequently, all the arrows pointed toward Judy Randall. And this is something that's not unknown, again, to our people who have more experience in tourism than I. She has done work also in Onslow County before for previous operators of tourism functions here in the county. Jacksonville is not unknown to her. And of particular interest for me was that she had recently completed a study of Columbus, Georgia. And as you know, wonderful Lorette found how Columbus has a tie for in their reunion development, their military reunion development, that is a really part there. Plus, Ms. Loftbow here, she has a real connection with Columbus, Georgia. So we'll be able to see how the data is and how that's working. I sent that to you digitally, and we can provide it to you in paper should you desire. We had a little issue printing today, so we're glad we got the agendas printed. But but we have all that for you. And so consequently, in your agenda packet is a proposal from her. This proposal is not only to bring in her to find out who stays overnight in the facilities, but it is also to put together a panel of other people who do recruiting and also help source markets in that. And this is where our partners will be sitting with us while we listen to them talk about, okay, here's what you have, here's markets that you could expand to. And one of the people that has agreed to come is the person with Columbus, Georgia, and will participate in this. So this amount that you see here, this $21,000, is an all-inclusive amount for travel, for the booking of the agents that will come. And such like that. So that is all together, you know, and one price in there, and the finance people like that kind of contract, and it's really easy to go from that deal. So we, the staff respectfully ask you all to consider whether you wish to go with this proposal, and if so, we have a contract ready for you to sign, and she can get to work, and we're hoping to get this done. She is very sensitive to the fact about the legislative schedule. And so she is going to push all that she can to get this done well before the budget deliberations begin in the legislature.
What's the cost of it?
$21,000. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Glenn, math is not my strong point, but I see 11,000 and 9,000 above the 21.
Well, as you know, several of us are forbidden to do math in public.
Yeah, I'm one of them. $20,000.
Help us out.
Yeah, I just think we there was another need to somewhere that we didn't
edit that part of the contract. It'd probably be, I guess, 11 and 10.
Yes, that would be where I would think it there. We did get her to change the contract very quickly when we went forward there. But
I mean, I'm not strong in math.
No, but. You know how to pay the bills in your office.
Yes, we've already attached our boilerplate language to this. If you approve it, we're ready for signature.
All right, thank you. So you guys will make the adjustments on the numbers then?
Yes, sir.
All right, what's the pleasure of the board?
You need a motion? I'll make a motion.
Okay.
There's one provided for you.
Okay, motion to accept the proposal with the study panel and authorize the chairman to sign documents to proceed with the project.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. Motion carries. Next order of business is going to be the wayfinding update.
As you know, we have we can go forward with the signs for the Jacksonville Commons and work toward the signs that will be done at the Beirut Memorial Grove, pursuant to the appearance before the City Council. In doing so, what we have, as you know, is a design intent document. And while it looks like to me it's a great thing for someone experienced at this end of the table that knows that's not enough yet to build the sign, that you need someone like him to make it and change it in such a way that it actually can be built using the materials that they specify. In doing this, we reached out to some other communities that have done this before, that have done wayfinding signs in North Carolina, familiar with that. And a lot of people pointed to H.L. Buzz Vizel, who has significantly and successfully navigated North Carolina Department of Transportation encroachment agreements. Mm-hmm. He has engineers that he's associated with that get the building permits and doing the things like that as it was. And he takes design intent and he makes it in a practical way. He also does it and helps in such a way that it bids out the components so the components can be sourced as inexpensively as possible, and then he's responsible to find someone that will actually fabricate it and to erect it and put it up. He becomes the responsible person for this, so he would be the project person. We do not have any prices. We don't have any of that. He's going to make a scoping meeting here on March the 2nd and is going to look at this area. And we will be talking with him about the budget and what realistic expectations can be made. We have one estimate for the common sign that we've been using in-house and using as such there, and we don't have a firm number for the Beirut Memorial Grove signs as it is. And so we'll be firming that up also as a result of this.
And what's the cost of this?
This is no cost at this time.
Okay.
And so...
Just a proposal meeting.
This is a proposed meeting, and we just wish to staff to allow us to proceed with a potential that you... What we're asking for, is this a concept that you like? Obviously, one of the things the authority has to do is abide by the procurement requirements of the city of Jacksonville. And so this would meet those requirements in doing that. And as to, there's been some conversations about whether the city should pay for it and then the TDA reimburse them and some things such as that. None of that's been worked out. But basically
that'll
to get
all
us...
come back before us at
absolutely.
A later date. Okay. Thank yeah. you.
So you need a motion that's basically to proceed forward. To mm-hmm. engage. Not to contract, but just to move forward.
That is correct.
It'll have to come back to us for approval.
Approval once the figures get there. Mm-hmm. I make a motion to proceed to engage Bazell Design Company as project manager for the Waywood projects.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Aye.
All right, Glenn.
Well, the Visit NC projects, these are the ones that we do in partnership with the state. We were notified recently that the video that you had commissioned last year, that we did so we could get nice spring weather, as it was. That is now being played at North Carolina Welcome Centers. That was something that came as a byproduct. They did that for us. We didn't ask for it, and we're surprised by it. But nonetheless, appreciate it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the history.net, we're still getting some indications that has some value to us out there. The Rhythm One Influencer Program, this is one where we sent it down the chute there, and we don't know what's happening, but they'll tell us when it's time. You know, this is where they're finding blogs and social media that can be influenced as such there, when to have them come and visit us or talk about our projects as it is there. And so we're anxious to see how that project's going to come out. We don't know yet. And the social media spotlight, which we mentioned, that's March 14, 15, thank you. And the familiarization tour that we've got done, you've heard us lament about that as it was. If I might just finish with the key placements, with the only other one that we've done right now is the USA Today. When we go to the tourism conference, we're going to look at some more impressive ones. One of the things that you gave us the budget to be done is to buy some of those key placements. So we can make agreements as we go at the conference and get that done. No further branding implementation is underway at this time, and we're just repeating to you again when the state tourism conference is, as it was.
All right. Thank you very much. Any questions? No questions? Okay, we'll move on to item number 9. Marissa, the floor is yours.
Oh, thank you. First, I wanted to update everybody about Meeting Max. We have 21 hotels that have filled out all of the agreements. We do a one-year agreement with them. We have a couple of events up. Pickleball is the one next weekend, 36 room nights. We have Odyssey of the Mind has 11. Battle at the Beach has 32. And then there's a block of rooms at a hotel that we're not sure didn't go through Meeting Max, so we're figuring out what happened there.
Can you just give a quick recap on Meeting Max very briefly?
Okay, so Meeting Max is it's a website that we utilize to have individual events have their own page. We work with hotels, so pickleball, we said this is the rate that we're looking for, this is the block of rooms that we need, this is the time frame. Can you commit? So they'll put in, yes, I can commit to this. And there's a whole list of events that we will upload. And what happens is it creates this link. And we go back to the event owners to send out that link so that they can. The reason that they will do that, an incentive that we have built in, is that they get a dollar back from the $5 fee that the hotels tack on to that room night fee.
And it allows us to track rooms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's very easy for us to pull reports. It also helps the Sports Commission reach out to all the hotels and not just So it doesn't seem like we're just using this hotel for this event, or we only use this other hotel. It gives the opportunity for hotels that maybe haven't worked with certain event owners in the past, and it allows them to throw their hat in the ring when it comes to some of these events. So there, like I said, there's a $5 fee. $3 goes back to Meeting Max. $1 comes to Sports Commission, then the other dollar goes back to the event owners. We also have East Coast Invitational that is up right now. The weekend, it's like the weekend right before 4th of July. So we wanted to be able to get the hotels to buy in, because we know that that can potentially be a busy weekend. So we let them know that their logo could go on the invitations to all of the teams that are invited to that. So that's up on Meeting Max. And then tomorrow, our Freedom Fight amateur boxing event and Hot Import Nights will be up on Meeting Max.
Okay. So. Any questions?
I do have one.
Go She's ahead. Got more.
Okay.
Sorry, I do. Yes.
Well, any questions on what she has?
Okay, I was just going to ask, what did you say about Battle of the Beach?
Is Battle of the Beach.
Outside or something?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we're checking on it at the Fairfield. There's a block of 10 rooms that didn't actually go through Meeting Max, so we just have to go back and double check what.
And when was that, Battle of the Beach?
It's going to be next weekend.
Next weekend. Thank you.
Actually, I'll just roll into that. So the next, let me summarize. Sorry, we had our Marine Chevy Quick Stick lacrosse tournament this past weekend, and that was at OCSA, and we had all the teams show up, so that was good. We had 28 teams, 13 girls and 15 boys. We utilized 4 fields over at OCSA. We did over $2,800 for the gate. It was only $5 per person to get in. Each team had a minimum of 11 players, but up to 30. And then we did see a lot of the families travel in with them. We had teams from Raleigh and Fayetteville all the way down to Shallotte, I think is how you say it, and even up New Bern, Croatan. So a good variety of teams, some new teams, and some teams that came back from last year. Overall, we got really positive feedback. They loved this. We made sure we had enough signage and everybody knew where they were going. The officials did a really great job making sure there really weren't that many injuries. The first year, I think there was 2 ambulances that had to come out. So this year, we were prepared. We had Halls Run Rescue, and they had 2 ambulances out there. And then we had Synergy Physical Therapy had an ATC out there. So overall, I think we're covered with health. We partner with Anzo Tribe, and they do a wonderful job of making sure the fields are all taken care of. If I wasn't hearing back from a team, they always kind of communicate with different clinics that they go to, and we had vendors out there, and all in all, it was really good. Really satisfied with that.
This is the largest lacrosse activity now in Onslow County, correct?
I'm not sure, but I think so. Okay. There's only, out of the 28 teams, only 4 were from inside the county. So everybody else traveled in. Some brought a JV boys, a varsity boys, and a girls team. You know, so the word is getting out about the event, so we're really excited to see the growth. Next, we have, we partner with Doug and Dave, one's Swansboro, one's Jacksonville Soccer. Sanders Ford Battle at the Beach is going to be the 3rd and the 4th, so that Friday evening, they work with they do games at all the local high schools, and they even go to New Bern, and I think Croatan is another host. And then on Saturday, they're out at OCSA. So Battle at the Beach, this is the ladies' time. The boys is in August, and so that's why if you feel like you just heard about Battle at the Beach, it's because we just did the men's in August. And we also, as we mentioned, Hot Import Nights coming up. Working out logistics on that, marketing. We're really trying to market outside of this area. I know Kristen's been helping with some of that marketing. We have our partner Jam Projects there. They have their own connections outside of the state that they're working on. And then Hot Import Nights themselves, they go to many different shows. I know they just had one in San Diego. They are marketing through their channels as well. So we're hoping, I'd like the ticket numbers to be a little bit higher, but I'm waiting on an update. The update I got last week, feel like we could still do a little bit better, feel more comfortable going into the event. But all in all, logistically, it's coming together. We just got to make sure cars can all come here. They're actually setting up. They do it via social media. They say, where are you coming from? Hey, do you want to lead a convoy? So they've got one set up for Concord. There's one, I think, from South. So I think it's South Carolina. And these are two in addition to the ones that had already committed from October down. I think one was from Virginia, and I want to say one was from Florida, but I'm not 100% sure. So that's their way of trying to get more involved and say, hey, are you a part of a club? You know, we'll give you a deal if you can bring more of your club members here.
Very good.
So that's all I want to update right now.
All right. Thank you. You got a lot going on as well. Any questions?
Okay. Marissa, Hot Import Nights, that was the one that was going to come last year but never did, is that correct?
Yes. Okay. Hurricane Matthew prevented it from coming, and so this is actually a postponement from that.
It should be pretty large, right?
We're hoping.
Maybe citywide? Okay.
Yeah, we're going to be right out here on Newbridge Street blocking it off.
Okay.
And there's going to be a food zone, a kids zone, drone racing. I have flyers if anybody would like to take one. And some of the cars, I'm really excited to see the types of cars that are going to be coming in, but also the types of cars that are already here in Jacksonville that you might not always see because they're in these garages that hardly get used. So really excited to see that. And I know they have created a couple of categories like the Jeep category and truck category because of the area.
Right.
I'm excited to see
that's
all
smart.
That.
Good.
Well, sorry. Thank you. I appreciate the update. Kristen.
Yes. As Engaged Onslow, of course, it's the same busy weekend. We got our results back from our first month of running our digital campaign, and it performed 600% better than average. So that's very exciting. It targeted, of course, not your normal targets that we would target around here, but people who would have to come in and stay overnight. Excuse me. Sorry. Any bridal shops, any other expos, Crystal Coast had theirs in January and stuff like that, so we focused on that. I know that there's been a big push lately, and I spoke to Holly today, and she said tickets are really starting to kick up. So I think a lot of people were kind of waiting to get through the other expos and everything, and now they're focusing on ours. Of course, the PGA Wells Fargo Championship is coming very close. May we'll be here before we know it. We have started rolling out those ads. It's a Fly Here, Stay Here campaign through social media, and now that ad's taking the place of the Bridal Expo one so that we can start focusing on that until April. We feel like after April, that's kind of, the people are not going to necessarily fly in after that point. We may still leave a little bit in it, but that's going to be before we roll out our Onslow Outdoors campaign. We had a great meeting for our visitor guide, so happy to know that that's coming along. I know that Teresa and Amory spoke with Liz today about design, so that's getting very exciting. We're looking forward to that.
For notes, that's where we agreed to pay for the guide with Onslow County, so that's another collaborative partnership that you previously agreed to pay for there.
And then tomorrow, Melissa and I will be attending the Seymour Johnson Air Force Base travel show. It's a nice one. They're about an hour and a half away, so it's a nice drivable market, but some do come in town and stay. They enjoy the beach. We're closest beach for them, and they like the fact that it's a military-friendly community. We are taking stuff. Onslow Beach is also going to come as well, and so it's a nice way to kind of get them incorporated. And so maybe people will stay at their beaches, but they'll still come venture out because, of course, you need to come and travel for the restaurants and everything. And then I will be attending Travel South Domestic Showcase. I fly out the 12th very early, and I will be back the 15th. Again, the bonus of that showcase is that not only is a group tour, but it's also travel writers, so we can visit with some journalists. So as they're doing the fam tour here, I'll be promoting to journalists there. So we're kind of hitting them at both angles. February 9th, we announced our Hospitality Person of the Year. His name is Mr. Omari McLennan. If you frequent Cracker Barrel, I'm sure you would recognize him.
He's been with them for 10 years. He was their employee of the year three of those 10 years. He originally is from Jacksonville, Florida. He came with his ex-wife, and then he stayed because he fell in love with the people. And I did not prompt him to say it. He told me that himself. It was lovely. He ended up bringing his new wife and his daughter with him, and they're actually going to be taking their cruise in May. So it turns out that he actually has family that's taking a cruise, and so now, since he was named Hospitality Person of the Year, he's going to get to join them.
Oh.
As we're going to, yeah. So he was very grateful, and I think he was very excited about it, and he's a wonderful spokesperson for that award. Next year, I think they're going to have big shoes to fill. He gave a lovely little thank you and everything. He's actually an associate pastor with a church here in town and everything. Then lastly, we have replaced three of our African American Heritage Trail signs. As you know, Lorette asked the county for some money to help replace those. And St. Julia's, it's Mount Zion. Little Mount Zion out in Sneeds Ferry. And
we're going to do the one in Richlands.
Union Chapel.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And then we, I know Hammocks Beach is on the lineup for the next one because it's incredibly faded. There's a whole list that still needs to get done, but we're trying to do them in increments of three. Yeah. So if you get a chance, write out the new signs. They look wonderful. The before and after is quite surprising. It was very well needed, and we can prove that. And I know that they're also looking, it's true, and they're also looking at adding, of course, more stops along. And so we're going to start to look at redoing all the brochures and everything that come along with that.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good update.
Any
questions?
Lorette,
have anything?
No, I'm just going to grab hold and wear a tourism hat for the next 35 days or so, and then I'll get back to chamber work after that.
We're going to go ahead and discuss some occupancy tax collections and go through that. And
we're very privileged to have Mr. Alan Weeks here sitting with us today. The finance director wasn't able to attend this afternoon, but we thank Mr. Weeks. And so I'm sure he won't protest if we just proceed on. This is showing the collections thus far through February the 18th. Showing that the Western Boulevard area is continuing a significant hold over the other areas, with over 50% of all collections thus far received are coming from that area. This was taken on February 18th. February 20th is the deadline for posting these taxes as it is. Also, you'll notice that the nice thing is that we're up 14% from the period before, and that's a really... nice to see that.
Yes.
We like that rather than those negative numbers we were looking at, as it is there. And of course, over the two-year trend line of the county that occurred before we started collecting the tax, you'll see we broke out of the negative numbers there too. So that's a real positive from that perspective. Here's what those trends look like. As you see, we do see the cycles that occur in there, as it was, and that the that December is still an area that you can see throughout the trends, just happens as it was there, and that's what happens. This is something that I think really shows the difference now from this year, from last year. This is year-to-date collections. You see where we were when we began in FY11, when all the deployments and things were going on as it was. And of course, last year we were really feeling bad at this time last year. But you can see the number is above that, which was it for 15, and matches nearly for 14. So we'll take it and go from that and be pleased with that as it was. We hope that the aggregate of the efforts that's being made by our partners, and that those that you have done as incentives, are starting to see. I think when you add things like 84 room nights and the more than 1,200 room nights that we had as a result of, the aggregate of the Grand Prix series and things like that, it's got to have an impact on the bottom line. And we all know that the return on investment from the money we spend in sports development is seen very clearly as it was there. So, Mr. Chair, that's what we have there from that
Thank
perspective.
Thank you. It's nice to see positive numbers. Any questions? Okay. Future reports and activities. I think we've got a lot going on. Is there anything that the members would like to see or get a report on that you don't have?
When are you opening?
What's that?
When's she opening?
Looks like April, May. Pushed a little bit more again, but we're working on it.
Keep pushing.
Yes, I still have a job, so that's good.
That's a great thing. You're still learning your license working at night.
That's a great thing. Ernie, anything?
Soon.
No, I heard May 1st for them.
Great.
I can't wait.
All right, any other comments? Anybody have anything? Okay, well, again, I appreciate everyone. I'm sorry, Sergeant Major.
I just have one thing. April 12th and 13th, Marine South will be here.
Okay.
We're bringing 180 vendors to town. Going to be here from the 10th to the 13th.
Wonderful. Marine South.
Marine South. The Marine Expo that we do, I do three of them a year. Marine South, Marine West, and the one at Quantico.
That's great.
And they'll be here starting on the 10th of April.
Where's that going to be, John?
Pardon me?
Where will it be held?
Yeah, on base.
Yeah, right Camp there Reserve, but they stay out.
Right outside of the field house.
We might mention, sir, just in passing, that the next meeting you do is that where we ask you for anything that you wish to have in the new budget. And then we start with depending on the funds and what we have thus far, we are taking applications for the tourism promotion, tourism development funds, and we will bring you the first draft of those at that time.
Great.
Mike, just one thing.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to mention that from March 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th, there's going to be probably about 575 members of Omega Psi Phi fraternity, my fraternity, here in Jacksonville. They chose Jacksonville, North Carolina, as the site of the third council district meeting.
Wow.
Council district meeting includes all chapters from South Carolina and North Carolina. They will be converging on Jacksonville that weekend. They already have booked three hotels, I believe, already. So you're going to see a lot of purple and gold. It's not going to be ECU. It's going to be a lot of purple and gold that weekend. Once again, that's the weekend of the 16th, Thursday, 17th, 18th, and 19th. So you'll be seeing a lot.
March.
Of course, in March.
Of course. When else would it be?
So I just wanted to make that announcement. So if you see a lot of folks around at the hotels, that's where that's the reason.
Thank you. John, anything?
Yes, sir.
All right. With no further business, I want you all to look at that time. It's shorter than an hour. How about that?
Good job.
All right. You have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you.